Hello everyone, and welcome to Humanising Digital Learning, Strategies for Boosting Educational Outcomes, a Times Higher Education webinar in partnership with Cambridge University Press and Assessment. My name's Julia Gilmore. I'm the Branded Content Manager for EMEA and the Americas at Times Higher Education, and I'll be chairing today's discussion. Please note that a recording of today's webinar will be available on demand along with a summary article should you wish to revisit this discussion or share it on social media or with colleagues, which we really do encourage. And I'm delighted to be joined today by our panel of experts from academia and industry. So please allow me to introduce Dr. Dana Abdul-Rahim, Assistant Professor and Director of the English Language Centre at the University of Bahrain, Dr. Nick Saville, Director of Thought Leadership at Cambridge University Press and Assessment, and Dr. Tana Yapar, Director of the Department of Foreign Languages at TOBB University of Economics and Technology. So thank you all so much for joining us today. And those of you in the audience will be able to put questions to the panel using the Q&A box provided. We'll try to answer as many of these as possible during the session, but we'll also dedicate around 5 to 10 minutes at the end for questions. Digital education is now an integral part of most, if not all, higher education institutions, with a wider variety of teaching, learning, and assessment methods available than ever before. However, it is important to take a human approach to digital learning to make sure that learners can achieve their fullest potential. So on that note, I'd like to begin by asking, what actually does a human-centered digital learning and assessment mean? Who'd like to go first? Dana, I'm gonna pick on you.
Okay, sure, yes. Thank you so much for inviting me to plenary speaker for this discussion. And I'm really looking forward to learning from the speakers and also sharing some of the insights that we learned, during the past few years where, digital learning has become a must and not just an accessory in the learning process. So for me, digital learning or human-centered digital learning would be, in a nutshell, an educational approach that prioritizes the needs of the learners and their experiences as well while utilizing digital technologies. But I was thinking about that question for quite some time yesterday, and I was thinking, a human-centered approach in your question. We can think about it as the learner. We usually talk about the learner-centered approaches for digital learning or learner-centered approaches to education. But when you say human-centered approaches, that kind of takes into account the learners, the students, and the teachers as well, right? So there are those two sides of the learning process, of the teaching process that are taken into account. So for the students, the learning process, and for the teachers, there would be a lot of where does the assessment come? Where does the ability to design the material, to provide the digital material for the students, tracking their progress and so forth and so on? So I really feel that this is an equation that takes into account not just the learners, but also the teachers at the same time.
Definitely. And Tana, what's your experience been?
Yeah, thank you for having me. It's a great pleasure to be here. So I also do like the term human-centered instead of learner-centered. As also Dana said that teachers are also important. So I feel like by taking into consideration the learner's characteristics, like on those in digital platforms, like the needs, interests, levels, prior experiences, cognitive skills, and providing them with differentiated learning, continuous feedback, autonomy, and so on, you also kind of make the learning process easier. And as a result, you also cater for the well-being, for the students and also the teachers. So nowadays, well-being is also a hot topic. So as a result, consequently, you are also catering for the well-being of both parties. But when you say, particularly human-centered digital learning platforms, for me, what should they include is what comes to my mind is multimedia content, virtual reality, gamification, authentic materials, adaptive learning platforms, and also authentic real-life like tasks and so on. And when you talk about assessment, digital assessment, The terms that pop up in my mind are fairness, transparency in assessment, and also being able to assess higher order thinking skills like creativity, problem solving skills, which are actually very hard to assess by traditional methods. And so when you say human-centered and when you think of assessment, again, we come to think of alternative assessment like projects and portfolios and so on. So doing this in a digital way, I think is a bit easier. And also it helps us to provide the students, the learners with continuous feedback, which I also feel like is very important. So that's all for me.
Nick, what's your experience been? What conversations have you been having?
Okay, well, first, that's great. Thank you very much for those two comments from Dana and Tana, because I actually agree with what they've been saying. I'd like to add, to start with it, for me, a human-centric approach is that the technology itself is built by humans for the purposes of human activity. So it should be designed for the intentions we have in education, right? And therefore controlled and managed to deliver the outcomes which we have at the center of our mission, which is to help people learn. So I would say, yes, a human-centric approach to language learning and in my case, assessment, refers to an approach which places, first of all, the learner at the center as the main focus that we have, and the learning processes that go around that, which includes the learner's needs, goals, and their individuality, right? So I think that's important. So we're therefore thinking, as was said, about the well-being of the learners, not just their cognitive and metacognitive development. So it needs to be social and emotional, if you like, the human touch, the things which make us human. So at that point, I would add in that a human-centric approach does indeed include all those who are involved, but it also recognizes the diversity of the learning context, the different cultural and linguistic backgrounds where learners and teachers have their activities. And that then comes down to issues like motivations and preferences, which some of which are culturally determined and some of which are based on individual preferences. So certainly one size doesn't fit all. That's, I think, the message. And I think that mirrors other trends in society, which we're seeing, a personalized approaches, right? Trying to make it relevant to me as the learner or to you as the teacher in your context. And you're seeing this, I think, in health and well-being more generally. So I've been following some discussions about personalized diets and personalized medicines. So people no longer think that a single diet, which is good for one person, which will help that person lose weight, will apply to me or to my family. We have different both physical and cultural reasons for why one size wouldn't fit all. So I'm thinking this is a trend in society which we are seeing in education now, that this sort of human-centric model.
Definitely. And I'd love to know how our panelists are kind of putting that into practice at their institutions, or if you are currently putting that human-centered model into practice.
Yes, so I wanted to add to the discussion, actually, before I talk about this, the fact that, like Dr. Nick said, it puts the learner at the center. And at the same time, it really empowers the learners because you're enabling them or giving them the ability to choose their time, the preferred time, their pacing, their individual differences. Whereas in a classroom, you know, you're going to be expecting everyone to work at the same pace all at the same time. But adding the digital learning tools would actually give them a little bit or let them reclaim a bit of that process and put them in control over the process itself, in the case that they can spend more time on certain learning material other than others, whereas other students might prefer to choose other material, you know, and spend more time on it than other, you know, material for other students. And so what we do in my institution, we have been kind of using a hybrid, if you want to call it, model, where the digital learning process, or at least when we talk about digital learning at the time of the pandemic, we used a bit of what we call a synchronous approach and an asynchronous approach, where it's either the teacher with the students at the same time using the digital technology and using the platforms, and using, you know, whatever tools they have at their disposal to actually do the lesson and go through the exercises and go through all the assessments. But at the same time, we also have the asynchronous, where the students are left at their own means with the assessments, the guided assessments, are, you know, enabled to go through the material at their own pace, like I said. So we did a little bit of both guided and less guided, in the sense that here is the material that you have to use. Here are the digital tools, the digital tools that you can use for your learning process, but you have to do that at your own pace, at your own convenience, and take your own time to be able to actually learn that more thoroughly. So we have been using, like, along with our material, our in-house material or material that comes from the publishers that we collaborate with, we would also have, you know, the exercises that they would have online from the that accompany the textbooks, or we would have our own, like the resource center would have also some online textbooks with their guided questions, comprehension questions, and exercises that the students can also use for their learning process. So this has been really helpful. It has been, like I said, empowering for the students to choose what to learn, when to learn, what levels, like, because we're talking about teaching English, and we're talking about a classroom that has different levels of students, or varying levels of students at various CEFR levels. And so the students are actually able to choose material that would help them boost their level and reach the class level if they are a little bit behind, or, you know, challenging them more if they feel that the class is a little bit, you know, too easy for them. We can even challenge them with more harder or more difficult material. So I think this has been really working in the favor of our students and favor of our staff members as well, because I mean, it's not easy to personalize in a traditional classroom setup, to personalize the learning process for all the students if you have a classroom of 30 or 35 students. But then when you have those digital tools, you're guiding the students to go somewhere to find what material actually works for them. And I think this is what has been the greatest benefit for us. I mean, in addition to all the assessment tools that are available out there. But I think that would be more of Dr. Nick's, you know, field of expertise. And so I think, yeah, so that would be our experience with actually, you know, the practice of our institution for digital learning.
Fantastic. Thank you. And Tana, what's your experience been?
I mean, when we're talking about being human-centered, we cannot, of course, just limit it to the digital platforms and digital assessments. So having a human-centered digital platform and assessment, on the other hand, being not human-centered in the physical classroom, of course, doesn't make sense. So it actually should be, if you want to be human-centered, or before we used to say learner-centered, it should be in your mission. It's actually in our mission at the moment. which means that also in the physical classroom, we are human-centered, and we are trying to ensure that constructive learning takes place, student-centered instruction is followed, and teachers are the facilitators, for sure. That's the implication in our institution. By the way, I'm talking on behalf of a higher education institution, but I want to be more specific in terms of that I am running an intensive language program, which means that when students come to university, they go through an English preparatory program. And at the end of the English prep program, when they pass an international exam, and they are ready to start their studies in their department. So I'm trying to give the examples from that context. So as I said, it should be our general instructional approach. And in our institution, then we come to discuss like how much time should we allocate for digital learning platforms. So sometimes you go flipped, sometimes blended. Then there is this digital component. How much for physical, how much for the digital platforms is something that we keep discussing also in our institution. And then we also brainstorm about which is better, humanized online platforms or hybrid online learning. So you have 50-50, and then you have this real physical classrooms, and on the other hand, you have the digital platforms, or should we just try to humanize online platforms and use them more in our curriculum? And I also kind of feel it's interesting because like 20 years ago, we were trying to digitalize our curriculum and the curriculum delivery. Now we are trying to humanize the digital platforms, but that's the way things go. That's how life is. And another challenge that we are also faced with is there are many digital platforms now on the market. Some are accompanying your textbooks. So of course, it's easier for us to pick the most appropriate textbook because you have this textbook evaluation criteria, which usually can be used for with slight changes for choosing different kind of textbooks, but it's getting more complicated when you are trying to pick digital platforms. Now you have these human-centered digital platforms. Some are supported by AI. So designing the appropriate criteria and using the appropriate methods to choose among them is also kind of a challenge for us. And yes, we do use digital platforms. It's now inevitable that all textbooks have their own digital component. And we are also trying to enrich our curriculum by also adding other extra digital platforms. They provide us with invaluable data with regards to student learning. So we value formative assessment a lot. And we also do use this data that comes from this digital platform to assess the students' learning process as well.
Fantastic, thank you. And Nick, I'd love to hear about how Cambridge helps institutions get the most out of digital, but like kind of retaining this human-centered approach. Oh, you're on mute, I'm afraid.
Sorry, there's some noise in the background. Anyway, thank you for that question. I just wanted to say that, reflect on what I've just heard, and then I'll come back to talk about Cambridge. Perhaps that'll come out in the conversation. I think two points, really, I was thinking about when you asked the question. First, that while the ed tech is relatively new, particularly some of the AI stuff, a learner-centered approach itself is not new, right? So we've been working on this as a continuation of the so-called communicative or action-oriented approach to language learning that dates back to the 1970s. And the focus is on fostering communication skills and language proficiency that's relevant and applicable to real-life situations of learners in their own lives. And the move we've heard about in that respect is on learning factors as well as content. So empowering the learner, granting choice, providing autonomy. And I think this is where the technology has been helping. The second point is about the point of hybrid, because I think the so-called new normal, which has emerged from the pandemic, is some form of hybridization. And that apparently was the word of the year in 2021, hybridization. It's different forms of putting different things together. So humans and machines, classrooms and online, this blending has become part of the new normal. And getting the blend right, as we've just heard from Dr. Tanner, is one of the challenges for us. But I think that's also an extension of what we were already doing. We heard the word flipped classroom or blended learning. So I'm thinking that now what we're looking at is to make that more coherent. And this is where I'd come back to where Cambridge is making a contribution by trying to create an ecosystem of learning that brings together the different components of a hybrid to make it work in a particular context. So whether that's a platform or whether it's content, which is for classrooms, or content online, the idea is to bring the whole thing into alignment so that it becomes more coherent, more easy to deliver, and more meaningful for the participants.
Thank you. We've just had some interesting questions in on the Q&A, so I'm just gonna go to that for a second. So Ayman Zaid asks, when designing digital activities and approaches, shouldn't we adapt an interdisciplinary approach when aiming at humanising these activities, like educational and psychological approaches, to make our pedagogies more humane? It's a big question. Nick, I feel like you have something to say about
that. A big thumbs up on that one. In fact, that is very much at the heart of the approach we take at Cambridge, because yes, we've been looking at automation and AI, particularly artificial intelligence, and how it can help, not for its own sake, but how it can help learning and learning processes. And about a decade ago, we established what we call the University Institute for Automated Language Teaching and Assessment. And the aim of that was to bring together computer scientists, technologists who do speech and speech processing, with pedagogical experts and assessment experts to use what we call design principles from the beginning to think about the solutions we need, rather than perhaps what you find happening or in the emergency of the COVID period is people trying to grasp any kind of technology and put it together in some way to make it work, which in some ways it did, because it got us through the emergency period. But I think we need to go back and think about how you construct solutions with the right people, as it were, in the room at the beginning. So bringing different perspectives so that the solutions are indeed interdisciplinary and collaborative.
Dana, did you have something to add to that? I saw you nodding along there.
I completely agree. And I think that because of the urgency of the matter during the pandemic, like everyone had to use whatever platforms, digital platforms were available. But I think, I mean, obviously not everyone was an expert at digital, using digital tools for teaching and learning, because what we did, or what a lot of people did, is basically bring the traditional classroom into the digital space, right? And bring the traditional type of assessment and learning process into just more of like an internet space to make it easier for us not to be there, together physically, but to just continue to learn. But like Dr. Nick said, this is not something new, but this is something that needs to be reconsidered. And these practices during the pandemic need to be reconsidered and reassessed. And how do we take it from there? What did we learn from that experience, the shared experience that all of human beings had during those past couple of years? And where do we go from there to actually improve on our practices in digital learning and, you know, digital assessment? So I completely agree with you, yeah.
Tana, what do you think?
Well, at this point, I would just agree with my colleagues.
I actually have a specific question for you that's directed to you, Tana. It says, Dr. Yapa, what data/learning analytics do you use or suggest to use to help with a personalized approach to support learners?
We should use the data wisely. So what when you say data analytics, I would say the more you have data, the more powerful you are. So if you can gather from data from as many resources as possible, it means that you are doing more reliable assessment, because just basing your decisions on a single or a couple of achievement tests on proficiency test is not always wise. So if you have lots of sources, then you are on the safe side, in my opinion. And digital platforms do also provide you with such kind of data. Like you get scores as a result of those tasks and so on. But I'm also looking forward to, my suggestion would be, to digital platforms which are also doing the assessment as part of the learning process, and also constantly providing you with information about their learning trajectory. So on an let's say on an international scale, for example, on the IELTS or on the TOEFL scale, or on or global scale of English, or whatever. So while being exposed to personalized learning and following that track, by completing those tasks, the way I would prefer is to get data from these digital platforms, which informs us about their point on this growth trajectory in language learning, I would say.
Definitely.
I hope I could answer the question.
Thank you. I think, talking about assessment and feedback is such an integral part of digital learning tools and such an advantage, especially with something like language learning, where kind of practice and constant feedback is so important. So can you share any best practice on how this can enhance the learning experience and the outcomes?
Can I pick this one up?
Of course you can.
Yes, I mean, keeping in the theme of human-centric, that is learning-oriented, I think that we're moving away from the traditional distinction between formative and summative assessments. Mm. Formative, something that happens in the classroom. Summative is a high-stakes exam, like IELTS or a Cambridge exam or whatever that comes at the end. I think what we're now seeing is the need to integrate, as we've just heard, different types of assessment to support learning throughout a learning journey. If you want to see, we heard about a trajectory, we can see it as a journey or a progression that goes from one level of proficiency to another, or from one school cycle to another, for example, from school to university. So what learners need is to know where they are in their learning and how to improve. What teachers need, or decision makers need, is how well they're succeeding against the learning goals and whether they achieve the outcomes needed, for example, to go to university or to travel to another country. So what we're seeing now is something, I think, which is more an integrated learning and assessment model, It comes from a theory, I would say, of learning-oriented assessment, which has emerged in the last 20 years, which breaks down the traditional distinctions, but sees all types of assessment as in place for helping to support learning. So placement tests, progress tests, practice tests, outcome tests, they all need to be aligned to the learning goals. And the role of the teacher in providing formative feedback in the classroom, or increasingly to use digital tools, which are under the control of the learner, for example, to do in their own time or as part of their homework, providing information to both the learner and the teacher about what each learner is doing. So moving away from the whole class model, which we heard about from Dr. Dana, towards more individualized, how do we deal with each learner's needs? And I think the digital tools that we're developing in Cambridge are designed to form part of this new way of thinking about learning and assessment. I can give some examples in a minute of what we're doing.
What do our panelists think about that? Our other panelists think about that? Dana, I'm going to go to you.
Oh, sorry. I agree. And I think for me, I could talk on a more a micro level of, you know, from the perspective of teachers, for instance, providing feedback is very time consuming, right? And so with these digital tools, what we can do is, at least what it does is that it takes a little bit of that heavy lifting from the responsibilities of the teacher of providing, for instance, grading all the exam. If it's an exam that can be, let's say, automatically graded, we're talking about, like, let's say, multiple choice questions or something like that. But when it, what that means, I mean, if the digital tool can help us take part or take care of at least some of these parts, that would leave the teacher with more of a, you know, more of the time to provide valuable feedback for the students on things that, like, for instance, writing, writing techniques and grammatical structures. And I know digital tools can also provide feedback on that stuff, but I mean, the human part in assessment shouldn't be completely absent there as well. I mean, I would actually be more interested in learning about the digital tools designed in Cambridge so that we can learn on how to integrate some of these in our programs as well. Because like I said, we are trying to integrate these tools, but like I said, at the end of the day, there's still the very heavy human component still available there. But what can these tools provide for us, or what these tools would be, what we would want them to provide for us is to help us also take that up. And like Dr. Tanner said, is help us figure out these patterns in the student learning progress to, you know, provide the teachers with more insights on how to help different communities of students or different groups of students or different levels of students. So it would be great to hear about what also Cambridge is doing.
You want me to come back in now, Julia? Or...
Yep, go ahead.
Well, clearly, digital platforms are there to support classrooms, and they're not to take classrooms away, and they're not to get rid of teachers. I mean, that's, I think what my main point is, it's the human and the machine combination, the hybrid, which we're looking at supporting. But we've got a new mobile friendly learning environment for language learners and teachers called Cambridge One, which you might look at. And within that, it's got some how to delegate to learners to practice for taking tests, but also how they learn by using test type materials to understand what they can do and can't do. So There's something there called test and train, which you might look out for on YouTube, where there's some explanations of that. And of course, we've been thinking about making assessments more effective for use in institutions like higher education by making them more available and more convenient, based on being digital and with auto marking, which uses AI, artificial intelligence, for both the speaking and writing. So not just the multiple choice type of heavy lifting that you would have from traditional practice materials, but making sure we keep a focus on probably the skills that are most valued by learners, which are the productive skills, and particularly writing in an academic context or for academic purposes. So you could look at our lingua skill if you wanted to find out more about that. But one thing which is really interesting, I think, which gets at some of the points and which is free to use for anybody, is write and improve. So if you just Google write and improve, it'll come up immediately. Now, this is a system we've designed to help learners improve their writing skills. It's linked to levels of proficiency benchmarked to the Common European Framework of Reference, or the CFR. So learners can log on to this tool free and can practice writing the kind of tasks that you find at different levels of proficiency, from very basic short notes or small level communication type tasks to longer essays. And it's submitted to the machine, if you like, which automatically gives it a score within 10 or 15 seconds. Mm-hmm. But also, more importantly, it's designed from both pedagogical and machine learning purposes, natural language processing purposes, to focus on particular aspects of the writing, which the learner can then think about improving, right? So it's not just saying you've got some errors, put them right. It's saying you are at B1 level, or approximately B1 level, in this writing. Here are the kind of things in your text you can address. So the learner can then think about it, rewrite or improve, as the name of the program says, write and improve, and resubmit it, and get immediate feedback within seconds to see whether the change that has been carried out by the learner in her mind, thinking about what have I got to do, has actually made a difference. If not, she can have another try. Actually, you can have as many tries as you like. That could work, and the learner could be making progress. But it's also interesting how this can be used in a blended model. Mm-hmm. So if the teacher has 40 people in the class, how often will that teacher give a writing exercise to the class and correct it? Once a month, perhaps? And in correcting it, the heavy lifting is too heavy. I mean, to actually do a diagnostic analysis of each student. Mm. What the teacher can do is, if you use this tool with a class approach, which you can do, the teacher can collect in all of the evidence that the students have provided for themselves initially, but also for the benefit of the teacher, who can then scrutinize which learners have been practicing, how they have been doing, whether they've been apparently making progress. And they can also focus in on the type of errors or the type of problems they've been experiencing, and provide a human touch, because the automated assessment, the AI, sometimes cannot understand what the learner has done. It can understand the grammar, but it can't understand the meaning well enough. But the teacher can then step in and say, I see what your problem is. I can also help you by guiding you to some more practice or some more learning materials, which will help you get over this problem that you have. And the teacher can then choose different things, as well as perhaps a general thing, to highlight the personal differences or individual differences. Yeah. And so the teacher then is doing what teachers do best, is focusing on the teaching and learning, yeah, and not in the correcting of 40 scripts, which are difficult to do in a very systematic way. So this is what I think of as the emerging benefit of a machine working with a human, as long as the machine has been designed from pedagogical principles to fit in with this sort of hybrid way of thinking. So it's effectively an ongoing learning-oriented approach to assessment that has some formative and some summative dimensions to it, and can be used as a tool for self-taught learning, or can be integrated within a curriculum-based model in schools. Does that provide you with some ideas, Dana?
Absolutely, yes. And I was thinking, because when we were talking about writing, I was thinking about exactly what you said, like how many times a month can you, it's inevitable to have large classrooms sometimes when you have a large intake of students. And so how many times are you going to be able to provide them with writing that you're going to have to correct yourself? And so that's one thing. And another thing is, like, for instance, imagine the teacher would take the writing from the students today, and that would take him or her another week to correct. The student would have already lost interest in what they have written. Yes, they have forgotten what they wrote. The instant feedback that a tool can provide them with, or the instant, targeting of certain parts of the writing that can help the students focus on their weaknesses or what areas they can improve, is definitely something that would make
it's
the
really important,
process
isn't it? Timely, it is, feedback,
yes.
Getting the
instantaneous feedback. Yeah, yes,
yeah.
Absolutely,
so usable, yeah. And timely. It's got to be usable,
yeah,
as well.
That's really great. Yeah. All
and
right.
It
thank
increases
you.
The motivation as well.
Mm. Absolutely, yeah, because you get some visible aspect of progress. Or the student is building on this idea of empowering and autonomy by getting the student to think about, to reflect on, mm-hmm, their learning, as well as, mm-hmm, simply being told you've got, I don't know, 6 out, yeah, of 10, or you're getting the past, yeah, tense wrong, which is not very easy to use.
And I'd like to kind of touch back on something that we have been mentioning before and is coming up in the Q&A box, which is the question of AI, generative AI, such as ChatGPT. So, mm-hmm, how do you see these tools being used in higher education alongside human expertise? Tana, I'm gonna go to you first, because there was definitely a question directed towards, mm-hmm, you on this.
Actually, we talked about digital platforms, and now we shouldn't perceive AI as something different from digital platforms. In my opinion, AI should start to be an inseparable part of digital platforms by now. And it has also started to become. For me, AI should also help us. Now we are talking about being personalized, differentiate the instruction. Then your designing your curriculum becomes very sophisticated. That's also what we have been talking about here. So in a traditional curriculum development process, you would do the needs analysis, design your program, monitor your program, and then summatively evaluate your program. But you have a single curriculum here, which you think would touch the needs of all the students. But now you have curriculum and mini sub-curricula, lots of curricula, as part of it. So I feel like AI should also be part of the curriculum development process. So about how we should differentiate and how we should personalize the curriculum, the curricula, and help us in the design, the needs assessment and program evaluation. And I also feel like, yes, by adding human to the digital platforms, we are trying to humanize digital platforms, but also do feel like adding AI to digital platforms also to some extent helps us to add a human touch to the digital platforms. For example, I don't want to give the name at the moment. We are using a digital platform where students are practicing speaking and learning vocabulary on this digital platform. They are exposed to authentic videos, which is according to their levels, because first the digital platform assesses their levels. And by watching those videos, they are learning vocabulary, they are practicing pronunciation. And in the end, they are practicing the vocabulary. And the final task is with a chatbot, with ChatGPT. So at the production stage, you are having a chat with ChatGPT based on the video that you have watched, and also the target vocabulary is trying to be included here. And the discussion that you are having with AI is not, of course, same for all the students. It's personalized, and you are having your own chat with ChatGPT. So I also, the thing with assessment also excites me a lot, because Nick calls it as heavy lifting. It's heavy lifting for both sides, both for the teachers and also for the students. And with heavy lifting assessment, you have a one size fits all kind of assessment for the students. But with AI, I feel like unconsciously, you are constantly being evaluated about your proficiency level. And that provides you with a stress-free learning process, which is very important. So now you are also human-centered. You are caring also for the well-being both of the teachers in terms of saving the time. And also you are caring for the well-being of the students by providing them with a stress-free environment and doing it in a personalized way. Yeah. It's scary, but on the other hand, it's also exciting, because I can also share with you my own experience with ChatGPT. We had been talking for quite some time with ChatGPT, and in the end, I asked ChatGPT, would you please assess my proficiency level? And he or she or it said, you are around B2 level. And I said, I'm an English teacher, so how come you think I'm at B2 level? So it's instantly listed. it instantly listed my typos and my typing mistakes that I made and so on. And so I guess this is also going to develop. So not just looking at the typos, but maybe it's also assessing the complexity, of the sentences that we are creating. And another interesting question I asked ChatGPT was that, okay, you think it's B2 level. How would you assess it on the IELTS scale? And I received an answer. It wasn't an exact, but I was provided with an interval by ChatGPT. That's very interesting. And another experience of mine, which we are currently working on with our assessment unit in our department, is I provided ChatGPT, let's say, with our rubric to assess the student writing. And I asked ChatGPT, would you please analyze my rubric? It provided me with a quick summary of my rubric and my grading scales. And then I provided ChatGPT with a sample student writing, and I asked ChatGPT to assess it by using my rubric and provide the learner with feedback. It was done successfully. And now we are analyzing it, how close its grades student writing to in comparison to a human writer. So I guess that's very, very exciting, but prompting the AI currently is very important. You should provide AI with the relevant and with the best prompts. But I guess this is also going to develop, maybe providing AI with simple prompts will also be possible, but prompting carefully, correctly seems to be an important issue at the moment.
Well, we've got about 10 minutes left and we've got so many good questions in the Q&A box. So apologies in advance if I don't get through them all, but I'm just going to go through a few of them. So one question says, with regard to humanising digital learning, and since face-to-face communication is the richest form of communication and arguably the most humane form, how can we ensure that both teachers and students are aware that learning is inseparable from the humans who are delivering them? And how can we ensure that this process is humane and offers that special connection between learners and educators? A lot to think about on that one.
Yes, yeah.
To some extent, we've been talking about it already, I think, because we see the solution as a human-machine combination, right? What we need to do is to make sure that we understand when the benefits are there of interacting with a machine and when the benefits are there in a different way with interacting with humans, and when the two things come together in ways we've been talking about. The ChatGPT is a very interesting thing because, and you know, the world of Alexa or Siri, because we've actually got here an emerging form of communication, which is different from the way that humans interact with each other, but uses many of the similar features. So that when you talk to Alexa or one of the other chatbots, You don't assume that that is a human. You assume it's a machine, and you adopt a way of speaking. So various forms of conversation that conversational techniques are not common when talking to a machine. Whereas the things you do in with humans is you establish a rapport by the interactiveness of your communication. You back channel. You comment on what the person is doing or saying. You seek to develop a thread. You can also change the conversation in different ways by signaling that you want to talk about something else. With machines, it's very functional. So we mustn't, I think, confuse when developing tools to practice speaking the type of conversation that you have with a machine and the type of conversation with a human. So when we design our learning and assessment materials, we have to be clear of what the purpose is in them. We mustn't be reductive because a machine will just do question and answer, that we turn our concept of speaking skills into just a Q&A with a machine, because that would be reductive to the point of absurdity. You need to think about, can we challenge ourselves to develop machines that can interact with humans much more like humans? Or are we really going to have to rely on the human touch by having humans talking to humans if we want to create that real personal conversational model of communication?
Yes, can I say something about that also? I mean, I don't think we really need to worry about that, because from our experience coming back after the pandemic, I think everyone was, the students and the teachers alike, everyone was actually thirsty for that kind of going back to human interaction and getting the knowledge from the teachers at first hand. And I think, I mean, we can maximally digitize the learning the learning process at, you know, the maximum level, 90%, 100%. But at the same time, I mean, we are going to have to expect for that to happen, that there be accountability and students have a full sense of the responsibilities that they have to have as learners in order to be able to do, you know, individual self-studying on their own. And they have to also be completely digitally literate. But, you know, at the same time, we want to have the human guidance there. The human guidance is there. And these tools are, like Dr. Nick said, they're not there to replace the human interaction. They're there to aid, to help that human interaction, to facilitate the process but not to completely, you know, kind of obliterate it. I mean, I'm thinking of completely or fully digitized learning curricula is probably for more mature professional learners in setups where they have to learn or go through some material for work, for whatever, you know, vocation, something like that, but not in a usual like school university setup where that human interaction has to stay for some time. Hopefully it's never gonna go away, but that's my opinion. I mean, I'm all for using the digital tools there to help us, but not let that take over the entire learning process. Yeah,
if possible, I would like to provide you with an interesting example at this point. Do we have time?
Yep, definitely.
Yeah, you know, in Turkey, unfortunately, we suffered a huge earthquake. So some of our students were from that area. So we had to go hybrid, which means some of the students could not come to Ankara or didn't have the opportunity to come here. So they went online. Some students came to face-to-face classes. Some preferred a hybrid model. They sometimes came face-to-face, sometimes online. Don't you think that also providing the students with such kind of choices is a way to personalize the way you are teaching? Do you think we should be imposing the human touch or the humans in the classroom? That's also something that maybe we could discuss or think about.
Yeah, Nick, that's something you agree with. I saw your big thumbs up there.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes, yeah.
And this is another.
We agree a lot with each other today, don't we?
It's always what we want in a good webinar discussion. And probably got time for one final question, which was one I found quite interesting and think could be quite relevant, seeing as we have representatives from three different countries here. Could you shed a light on the cultural elements in the digital resources that might affect students' motivation to engage in these learning materials?
Cultural elements in the digital resources, thinking about that, okay.
Most countries now are familiar with the use of digital tools, I think, even quite the global south, there is quite a lot of penetration of digital technology, you know, in Latin America and other places. So I think familiarity, but I think access and distribution is one of the big problems, which is more sociopolitical than cultural, that there is a digital divide, that a lot of these tools are not going to be suitable if they cannot be put into the hands of the learners with. But once you can, the connectivity that it creates, it enables all kinds of new cultural and other kinds of activity, which includes learning, and language learning is part of that. So intercultural issues will always be a concern when learning languages, right? Mm-hmm. Everybody starts with their home language and their school language, and they learn other languages. So it's effectively a multilingual, multicultural activity that we engage in when we teach other people languages. So you add in any form of schooling or use of materials or curriculum design into a context which is culturally diverse. And I think this is something which is no different when it comes to technology. It just adds another layer which we have to think of because of the, you know, the access to it and how people can use it.
I think, unfortunately, that may bring us to the end of our discussion. So I'd like to thank our panel so much for taking part today. It's been fantastic. And to remind everyone watching that there'll be an on-demand recording and a summary article of the discussion available on the Times Higher Education website in due course. It'll also be emailed to you. And I hope you found today useful. I know I have. And we hope to be able to engage with you at future THE events. So thank you so much, everyone.